Thank you very much for checking out our second edition of the CCAA webinar series, Making an Impact Beyond the Court, presented by Verburn Medical Supplies. The goal of these panel discussions is to identify topics that are important to the CCAA and its stakeholders and invite experts to provide their insights. Today's topic will discuss the impact that three CCAA member institutions have made on campus and in their communities using sport as a conduit. I'm your host, Eric Moffitt, the Marketing and Event Coordinator at St. Thomas University in Fredericton, New Brunswick, and a voice of numerous CCAA National Championships since 2005. We have three guests with us today from the CCAA member schools, and we'll include their personal and professional backgrounds as well as their relationship to the CCAA. So first, I want to introduce Michael Kopanak from Humber College.
Sure. First and foremost, I'm glad you called me an expert. Let's start there. I'm not sure that I am, but thank you so much for having me. My name is Michael Kopanak. I'm the Associate Director of Athletics at Humber College. I've been at Humber for, about 20 years, but I've been there in various roles, mostly student life related roles. I've been in athletics now for probably the last 7 or 8 years as the Associate Athletic Director. Absolutely love it. I guess it's a dream job. I think we would all say that. I'm also, I guess my relationship to CCAA as well is I am the National Badminton Convener as well. So, and it's sad that we're not going, but hopefully soon.
Well, thank you very much, Michael. And up next from Medicine Hat, we have Terry Ballard.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for having us today. And I as well am happy you called us experts, so we'll try to do our best here today. I actually have a little bit of a longer association with the CCAA. I was the athletic director at Medicine Hat College way back in actually 1991 for a few years. Then I took off for a bit, and then I moved on to the north of Alberta up to Nate, and I spent 15 years there as the head coach of the men's hockey team. And was fortunate enough to stay in athletics, and the job came open back in Medicine Hat again. So I came back here, and I am now the athletic director here again from 2012 to now. And very, very happy to be part of not only ACAC, but the CCAA. And thank you again for having us on this call. Look forward to sharing a few bits of information.
Thanks, Terry. And now all the way to the West Coast, over to Capilano University, is Chris Rayside. Tell us a little bit about yourself, Chris.
My name is Chris Rayside. I'm the Athletic Events and Sport Development Officer at Capilano University. I've been involved with the CCA for about 10 years now. Not nearly as seasoned as these two gentlemen I'm with. My involvement with this webinar comes out of CapU support for the 2018 Junior All-Native Tournament on the North Shore here. It's an annual provincial First Nations youth basketball tournament that we were involved with in 2018.
Well, as Chris mentioned, he was involved with that basketball tournament. Terry has a celebration of women and girls in sport at Medicine Hat, and Michael was involved with the Here to Play, the hashtag Here to Play at Humber, and they were recognized by the CCAA as either a community service or Innovation Award winners for those initiatives. These awards identify CCAA member institutions that successfully develop and administer community relations programs or unique marketing and communications initiatives. So if we get right into it, the primary mandate for every CCAA member is the administration of an athletics program. So let us begin by each of you explaining how the decision to initiate a social campaign originated from within your world of sports. So first, what we'll do is we'll throw it to Michael at Humber, and then we'll follow that up with Chris at Capilano, and then Terry at Medicine Hat.
Sure. I guess the decision ultimately is an easy one. You know, we believe at Humber there is some great power in sports and the ability to get out strong and powerful messages. And we made a decision a number of years ago that it was really important to hit home on things like inclusion, diversity, sexual violence, mental health, and the list kind of goes on from there. So we decided that we were going to make a series of short videos, I'll call them public service announcements, that would really hit some of these topics. But the point of the videos was not just to kind of end there. It was just that was a way to kind of start what I would call the communication and dialogue. And we from there, we decided to ensure that we were doing extensive training, both for our staff and for our athletes. And, you know, ultimately, why did we do this? Create awareness, show support for marginalized groups, and ultimately to create meaningful conversations. We have a mandate in athletics to create champions off the court and on the court. And I use off the court first because of that significance and that importance. And we believe this, you know, ultimately will help develop our athletes into hopefully good global citizens. And so I think, you know, there's a few reasons why, and we could probably talk longer, but I'd love to hear from the other gentlemen as well.
Yeah, I'll throw it over to Chris if you want to follow up with that.
Sure, yeah. So just first off, so Capilano University is actually named after Chief Joe Capilano, an important leader of the Squamish First Nation of the Coast Salish people. So having said that, we respectfully acknowledge that our campuses are located on the territories of the Lilwat, Musqueam, Seashell, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. So having said that, one of the major themes in our CAPU integrated plan is honoring our commitments to truth and reconciliation. So the opportunity to be involved with the 2018 General Native Tournament came up as it was hosted on the North Shore by the local organizers. They approached us, so it was kind of an easy decision there. As one of the other panels just said, it's I think a really important part for us to be involved in our community, especially on the North Shore, with our connection to the local Indigenous community, First Nations community. So this was a really great opportunity for us and a fantastic event to be involved with.
Yeah, so Terry, how about on your end on celebrating women in sport?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks very much. For the last few years at Rattlers Athletics, we tried to really focus a little bit stronger on our three pillars, we call it, which was academics, athletics, and citizenship. So this goes under the heading of citizenship for us. And we also did some strategic planning a few years ago. One of our goals was to host every ACAC conference championship that we were a participant in, and it ended up being that the last two that we had to fulfill our commitment to ourselves was women's volleyball and women's basketball. So we knew that if we were going to present a bid and try to get the two together, it had to be unique, had to be a little bit different. So that's where the idea stemmed from initially, was to present these two as a package and create it as a celebration of women and girls in sport. And we identified that as a strong need, not only in our community, but, you know, certainly across the country and other provinces as well, to create role models for young girls to look up to talk, to identify with. And then from there, we created our bid package. And before we went to present our bid, actually, we met with a local group here. That's, their acronym is FAME, which is FAME. And they're called Females in Action Moving and Empowering. And we discussed this bid with them because we wanted to get their support and a letter of support from them, which we did. They were so excited about it that we invited two of their members to sit on our organizing committee. And they're the two people that sort of galvanized the whole special events that we created around our conference championships. So, and we'll discuss those in more detail. But that's the initial part of how we got started. And it went really well.
Perfect. Now, I know that, you guys have already kind of dabbled a little bit onto this, but I know that once the group established that you wanted to implement a social initiative, how did you identify the cause that you wanted to support? So, I mean, was it, you mentioned about outside stakeholders that kind of approached you, or was it a bottom-up approach or top-down approach? We'll start off with Chris with the Indigenous basketball tournament, then we'll go on to Terry and then on to Michael.
So for us, the organizers approached us with the opportunity. So it was more of a discussion around how we could best help. And our venue was just sort of the championship venue. So yeah, they reached out to us. And then obviously through our connection to sports through our Varsity Athletics program and our connection to truth and reconciliation on the North Shore through CAPU and our sort of direction there kind of made it a pretty easy decision. So, and they were fantastic to work with and great people.
So Terry, on you, I know you mentioned that fame group, but let's talk a little bit more about how you wanted to identify with that group.
Yeah, we do a lot of community service here. We have a Rattlers Community Engagement Program, and one of our partners in that program is Big Brothers and Big Sisters. And what we recognized through that was there's a lot of opportunity for little brothers, but there doesn't seem as many for little sisters, is what we found out in talking to them. And so that's sort of one of the galvanized things that started us to think about this celebration of women and girls in sports, because young girls, they need those role models. They need to have people they can identify with and say, look, I can get there. And just bringing this idea and putting the bid together and bringing it to the FANE group that I mentioned earlier, emphasized to us that we're on the right track, that we do have support from the community to put this event on, or these events, because it was a back-to-back kind of situation. So being able to talk with community members in the Southeast Alberta area, that over and over it was repeated that there was a need for creating role models for young girls in sports, and at the same time celebrating all the accomplishments that they do. So that's what got us going.
Michael, how about you on your end?
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much. I mean, we have spent significant time in athletics trying to build relationships with partners with, inside our community. So our LGBTQ plus resource center, our BACE, Black Academic Success Center, and the list kind of goes on from there. You know, when we've done some focus groups and maybe some surveying, things like that, I was sad to say that not 100%, and I know that would be a tough thing to strive for, but not 100% of people felt safe utilizing the gym, utilizing the locker rooms. You know, our LGBTQ friends have said, listen, I don't feel comfortable we don't have gender neutral washrooms. We don't feel real comfortable in your space using the gym. There's a real masculinity feel, and we're just not feeling comfortable. So it was a very easy decision from there to say, hey, we need to do better. And creating those partnerships has really made a difference. Listening to the needs of various groups has really helped, and allowing them to be a part of these videos and training has made such a significant difference, and I think impact on those groups that maybe we weren't doing such a good job of in the past. We also focused a little bit, and we continue to focus on sexual violence, whether it's bystander training, and now I know the CCAA is doing some training across the sports as well, which I think is fantastic. We've had some survivors of sexual assault. And that's difficult to deal with. And we just felt we needed to, again, do better, train, talk about these things, and let's see if we can make a real impact. And I believe we are, and, there's lots of work to do, and we won't stop here, but I think we're on the right track. Building relationships, I think, has been key. Thank you.
Well, I mean, these are all very important social campaigns and bringing the community together. In each of these campaigns, sport has been an essential means of promoting your causes. So can you discuss a little bit about how sport was incorporated into each of those programs and the broader notion of why sport is an effective way of connecting with an audience and advocating for change? I mean, there's a lot on the table here about, what we're discussing about and providing safe space and reaching out to the broader community. So on this discussion point, I'm going to start off with Terry at Medicine Hat, then we'll go to Michael, and then Chris.
Yeah, certainly the two sports that we are involved with, women's volleyball and women's basketball, we don't think we could have had the impact we felt we did, and we were told that we did if it wasn't for those two sports. And those sports are big in our community, and at the same time, we wanted to ensure that that young girls had a place to look to and to achieve to. So, you know, sport was certainly the driver of the causes, of the cause of women and girls in sport. And from there, as I mentioned earlier, our organizing committee, we invited some folks from that FANG group to sit on it, and we assigned them the special event portion of the organizing committee, which essentially was all the things around the actual conference championships that we could do to involve women and girls from our community in these two events. And, you know, I could go on for in detail for quite a bit, but just an overview of a couple of the events that were special to the organization were, you know, getting some guest speakers. We had a CCAA Coaching Excellence Award winner speak for women's volleyball. We had a member of Team Canada's Olympic basketball team who played Kansas City Jayhawks come in and talk to the girls on basketball. And these are local Medicine Hat people. We had a program called Fill It With Females. So if you've gone to, conference championships around the country, you'll notice that the only people that attend are the participants of the tournament. So we wanted to get people to watch that. So our upper part of our theater, for example, held about 200 something folks. And we had 200 young girls for each of our championships come in and watch the award ceremony. And after the award ceremony was over, we actually had all the girls meet and greet with the team that could ask questions and sit down and meet a team from Keanu, meet a team from Edmonton and so on, and ask them questions about how they got started in sport, how they stayed in sport. We had a program called Get Bench Program, where we had two or three girls sit on the bench of every team for every tournament. So all 22 games from 11 and 11 of both championships, we had girls take part in the team prep talks, the team timeouts. During volleyball, they volley with the ball with the girls. So that was awesome. Player of the Game Awards. We had prominent community members that were all female come in and present Player of the Game Awards, and their biography was read off prior to the awards presentation. And we got to meet so many incredible women. One, for example, just sort out there, we didn't know we had in our community a world champion power lifter who was in our town. She came out and did the award. It was awesome. You should have seen her. And we had a couple of seminars we held with a couple of women that that came in and did some seminars for people on the Saturday of the championship. So, you know, those things are what's important. Yes, the participants want to play and they want to win and they want to do well. But, to me, if you're not planning other things that are around those championships, I think you're doing a disservice to the community. And so that's what we did, and it worked out fairly well.
All right, so now we'll throw it over to Michael.
Yeah, you know what? Maybe I'll just give a few examples because we're along the same lines. And I think, again, the power of sport is so important. And, in our institution, we've been fortunate. We've had a fair amount of success at Humber in varsity sport. And our athletes tend to be some of the more, I don't know, I'm going to use the word popular. I'm not sure if that's the right term. But they certainly... people look up to them and are watching them, and they are role models. And sometimes that's I think some of them feel that's a big commitment and a big undertaking, but that's part of being a varsity athlete. So two quick stories. Brendan Lyons, he's now an alumni, but he played for us in our baseball team for a number of years, first baseman. He came to us as a he was a pro hockey player, primarily a fighter. Pretty big dude, popular guy, real nice guy, white. The very first guy to put up his hand when we went out to volunteers and we said, listen, we like people to be a part of these videos. Who'd like to do that? He was the first guy to put up his hand and deliver a solid message on inclusivity. And boy, was that powerful and moving. And I think really made an impact for our student body as a whole. So that's one example. The other example is when we worked on our first video, which was about inclusivity, and we worked with our LGBTQ friends and partners, we created a banner together. So some varsity athletes had input in this banner. Some general students had some input, as well as the LGBTQ Resource Center, who actually ultimately made this banner. And we presented the banner at a basketball game, which was pretty high impact in terms of number of fans that were out. We were pretty full. Mohawk versus Humber. It's always it's not quite Mohawk versus, or not quite Humber versus Sheridan, but it's definitely we get a pretty good crowd. And at the beginning of both the women's game and men's game, our dean of students did a presentation. She is was at the time. She's left us since then, but she is part of the LGBTQ community herself, and delivered quite quite a moving speech to everyone in the gym. And then we raised the banner and together in front of a lot of fans. And so I think that was pretty unique, kind of starting off a high level basketball game with that kind of presentation. So for me, that's the power of sport and power of some of the things that we're doing.
Excellent, excellent. How about you, Chris?
Yeah, I'll actually go off on sort of the same sort of tangent there, the power of sport. For me, sort of sports, sort of like a shared language that allows people to connect. We had elders in the gym that were giving speeches in the opening ceremony. We also had a traditional dance that opened the whole thing up, and our facility was absolutely packed. So for me, I think it just comes back to relationship building, and truth and reconciliation, and going into it with an open heart and an open mind. And I think looking at things through the lens of sport, that's the commonality that we all share.
Yeah, I mean, Chris, you touched on it, and, you know, Michael and Terry as well, about the emotion, you know, that you feel inside when these initiatives bring a lot of power to the community, especially through sport. And obviously, you know, your programs have received recognition both locally and nationally. But can you speak to that impact of that campaign on the targeted demographic or social group, or their campuses, or even within the community that was felt, and, you know, some of the feedback that you received through that? For this question, I guess we'll start with Michael, and then we'll go on to Chris and then Terry.
Sure. Thank you. You know, this type of work, in my opinion, is never done. We're always learning. And at the end of the day, this is about about ensuring that we communicate and we have dialogues on an ongoing basis. And so all of this is really about being able to create that dialogue, because that's how we learn. At the end of the day, for us, I think the things that we've gotten out of this is we've built some exceptionally strong relationships with some of those internal services that I spoke about earlier. That's been key for us. Through this, because we've done this, you don't just throw up a video and walk away. We've done all kinds of training, training for our staff, training for our varsity athletes, training for the general student body. And I think that's gone a long way. And we need to do more training in various areas. I want to read you something. My original plan, and I think some of you might know this, was I wanted to bring on an alumni, a former athlete of ours who helped us with one of these videos and was a volunteer, but based on logistics, it just wasn't possible. But I'll just read you this quickly. From the very beginning, the idea of hashtag here to play was very important to me. No matter who I am, what color I am, or what I believe in, I'm an athlete just the same as my teammates and my competition. As a Black man, the very idea of acceptance is already something that carries a lot of weight for me personally. As we dove deeper into it, I began to see other students with different sexual orientations, religious beliefs, spiritualities, and the list goes on. These are people I've always loved and acknowledged, but it has been incredible to see them be loved and acknowledged as my fellow athletes. These are individuals who make up our schools, communities, services, businesses, etc., and their differences should always be celebrated. What makes a person different is indescribably beautiful. What I love about hashtag here to play in the CCAA is we got to take a unique look at what makes us similar. That similarity being that we're all, in fact, hashtag here to play. And I mean, that clearly was a message to our varsity athletes, But he was an excellent cross-country runner for us and also was one of the first people to put up his hands and be a part of our videos for kind of the general student population as well. So I hope that speaks a little bit to impact.
Yeah, it's a wonderful, wonderful story. Chris, how about you?
So for me, it was an amazing opportunity just to connect with the sort of local Aboriginal community here on the North Shore and improve those relationships. That's obviously a big component of reconciliation. I got into refereeing basketball as well. And then we also ran a local North league on the North Shore. So it was sort of unique. For me, it was a unique opportunity to see people that I've seen in our men's league. I've seen them coaching local teams, see them interacting with other programs, other teams, and the community that created. So for me, being able to work together with the organizing committee on the event was a great opportunity, because the event was a tournament. That was sort of, you know, an easy experience for all of us. So the overall joy was incredible. And just seeing all the young people, because the tournament's traditionally high school age athletes. So seeing them all coming through, being in the gym, meeting each other, I think just that shared experience, for me, that's the power of sport. And going through that together, that was just a heartwarming experience.
Well, I mean, it's great to see that diversity coming together in the community that we've seen with, you know, what Michael was doing with Humber and you, Chris, at CAP. You know, Terry, you know, for you, the lasting impact hopefully is in, you know, the empowerment of women and young girls. You know, have you already seen some of that impact that your programs have done, you know, like through the years and, you know, and where it's going on now?
Yeah, we feel we have, and we feel we will see more from this. We've received so many testimonials from parents and coaches that brought their teams or their girls to one of our special events, and it was outstanding. It was incredible. Just the direct impact we had on probably over 500 girls at some point in one of those special events that they took part in. And I realize this sounds corny, but you know, I did feel like we were changing lives, because we're creating people to look up to for these young girls, creating role models and so on. And I heard more than once during the two championships that a young girl would say to their mom on the way out after sitting on the bench or after doing something with a group of team, and said, "Hey, I'm going to go play for SAIT. I'm going to go play." I mean, we'd like them all to play for Medicine Hat, but it's not going to happen. But I mean, that's just so cool to hear that, because now, you know, a local kid from here, their favorite team, it may not be the Rattlers, and that's okay, but their favorite team is SAIT, because they got to know a female student athlete from there. And one small quick story before we move on is, there was one girl that just kept coming back and back to be on the bench, that Get Bench program that I mentioned, and she just loved the opportunity. So, and the fact she got a free t-shirt from every team as well, but she just loved that opportunity, that you can see her confidence grow over the 2 or 3 days of the championship. And right before, during warm-up, she went right up to the head coach and said, "Just so you know, every bench I've sat on so far, every team has won. So you're going to win, or it's your fault." So that was kind of cool to see that. But again, it's all about having an impact, changing lives, and creating something for a population to look forward to.
You know, we had some great initiatives that have been brought forward, and obviously we have numerous CCAA members across the country, and you know, sometimes some of these member institutions and, you know, their staff and coaches and student athlete members and the community members in those campuses, you know, may not know how to take that first or next step on trying to create a program like this. that you have brought forward at your campuses. So can you if you can offer me some insights or recommendations for those that may be interested in taking some similar initiatives on their own campuses and communities. So maybe Chris, we'll start with you from the West Coast, then we'll move over to Terry in Medicine Hat, and then Michael on this topic here.
Sure. For me, the biggest component is just openness and willingness to work together in a shared capacity. Obviously, we all run dozens of events every year, so we've got a lot of expertise there. But working with the local organizing committee on helping them see their vision through, for me, was super exciting. Myself and my supervisor, Milt, were gifted blankets as a thank you for the sort of the work we put in. And I've had mine draped across my couch over my shoulder here ever since. So I can basically guarantee that whenever I fall asleep on the couch, I'm usually wrapped up in that blanket. But yeah, for me, it just comes back to the idea, I guess, of truth and reconciliation and being open and willing to connect and wanting to just build good relationships and be good stewards for community. For me, that was really, I think, the biggest lesson, or not lesson, I think we've all learned that, but just actually being present in that moment and experiencing it with them, with 1,500 people in our gym, especially that opening ceremony, and just getting to be in that moment with all the participants was pretty moving.
Excellent. It's great to hear from that. How about you, Terry?
Well, taking part in these things certainly helps because I learned a lot thanks to Michael and Chris for sharing some of your stories and some of the things you do. And I made some notes, and we're going to steal some of the things you guys had mentioned. So I think that's one of the things, is just to continue to share ideas and, creating some kind of professional development session at the, maybe your conference level or maybe the national level, where we can share these best practices and these things we can do. And, I mentioned earlier that one of our pillars is citizenship and community, and that sometimes is almost more important than the other things, especially the game itself, because, we are in the business of creating leaders and creating community leaders for the future, and instilling these kind of values and ethics in our young people or young student athlete leaders is so important to do that. And I think we just need to continue to talk about that and to do that more. And the other opportunity we need to look for is chances and opportunities to invite people on your campus, to invite people into your home, which is your gymnasium and your playing surfaces. Maybe there's certain populations you want to identify. Maybe there's certain segments that need to be highlighted, and you invite them in to take part. And it's just, it could start off as something simple as recognizing who's in the spectator seating tonight. So, we have this group here, and the next time they come out, maybe they want to perform some kind of show. Maybe they want to speak. And that's how you create those relationships like we're all talking about as well. And the other thing that we're trying to do is, we did get some favorable reviews on some of the programs that we conducted. And I keep mentioning this Get Bench program. And the reason for that is because we've done this ourselves here with a couple schools for the last 5 years. Quite a task to do it for every game of championship. But the other institutions from our conference that participated really liked that program. So we are working with the ACAC at our conference to maybe create a template for how that program can be done, and with our member institutions. But certainly if we do get that done, and we have no issues with sharing that across the country, and I just think it's an example of making sure that we can share with each other and copy and try to improve on programs that are out there.
Excellent. Michael, how about you? Any best practices, insights, recommendations?
Yeah, these two gentlemen have outlined just outstanding ways to be able to reach out to you know, their community within their institutions, and obviously beyond within the community. And you know, you heard a lot about things like connections, relationship building. I mean, those things are so important. Bringing people in to your institution. We spend a lot of time, you know, we often hear that we learn, how do we learn to be racist? How do we learn to be, right? So it's very important to be connecting, I think, with our young. And if you get, you know, the children in watching your games and taking part in the programs, and some of the learning that you're doing at halftime and pregame is exceptionally important. Connecting with your campus resources. We've learned a lot from our campus resource friends, and I think that is important. Don't be afraid to take a risk. You know, some of these topics are not easy ones, and they are things that society struggles with on an ongoing basis. And look no further than some of the real unfortunate things that have happened in the U.S. Recently, just to know, you know, that racism exists. Diversity issues exist, and so don't be afraid to take a risk and make a statement. And that power of sport has that ability, I think, to make a splash. I mean, we all saw, you know, the various NBA teams. Was it Minnesota? I think you know, the statement that they made. Those are risk taking things. You know, not everybody always agrees that that's maybe the best way to do things. However, I think it certainly creates meaningful conversations any way that you look at it. And ultimately, I think that is what is important. Let's create these conversations. Let's work together. There are all kinds of great initiatives happening across the country. Why reinvent the wheel? That's the other thing. You know, if something is working well at a particular institution, I'm pretty sure that if you give them a call, they'd be willing to help you out and get you on the right track. And we'd certainly be willing to do that at Humber as well. But we're here to learn from, you know, we want to learn from all of you across the country. So, you know, thanks to these gentlemen, and thanks to everybody else who I think works so hard in CCAA to try to, you know, to try to ultimately do the right thing. And that's create great leaders and good, solid citizens. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you very much, gentlemen. So again, we had Michael Kopanak from Humber College, Terry Ballard from Medicine Hat, Chris Rayside from Capilano. And, you know, obviously social inclusion and empowerment is obviously a very important and powerful tool and the conduit of sport and what we've done here to make an impact beyond the court here today with the CCAA. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you for hosting. And,
yes.
Thank you.
And my apologies for being the presenting sponsor of today's webinar, as well as Sports Canada TV for providing great production support. We want to thank our viewers, and we hope that you found this topic to be valuable, and we encourage you to check out the other editions of our CCAA webinar series. My name is Eric Moffitt, and thank you very much for joining today's webinar.